Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Inductions. I will show how we can do something like recursive constructions using induction. In fact, induction will prove that this construction is valid, something like for all n in n. Okay, so I will start with very simple examples, very few simple examples which we have already come across. First one maybe, let's say, harmonic numbers. So they can be recursively defined like this, H1 equal to 1, and Hn equal to Hn minus 1 plus 1 over n for all n greater than equal to 2. Or I could have defined Hn plus 1 equal is equal to Hn plus 1 over n plus 1 for all n greater than equal to 1. Now, if I use the principle of mathematical induction, the weak form, special case, then H1 is defined by this. And if Hn minus 1 is defined, Hn is also defined. Therefore, this mathematical induction says, the principle says that Hn is defined for all n greater than or equal to 1. Likewise, I have defined Fibonacci numbers. We have already done it recursively. So we define f0 equal to 0, f1 equal to 1, and for n greater than equal to 2, we define fn equal to fn minus 1 plus fn minus 2 for all n greater than equal to 2. Now if I invoke the special, the general case of the weak form of mathematical induction with k equal to 0, k equal to 2, n, f0 and f1 are defined, these are the induction basis, and in the inductive step is, if n minus 1, fn minus 1 and fn minus 2 are defined, then fn is also defined. Therefore, Fibonacci numbers are defined for all n greater than or equal to 0. Finally, we also had something like a sequence. We have used this. A0 is 0. A1 is 1. A2 is 2. And subsequently, every term is sum of the three previous terms. N minus 1, An minus 2, An minus 3, 4, all n greater than or equal to 3. So once again, by the general case of the weak form, this sequence is defined for all values of n greater than or equal to 0, because k equal to 3 in this case. So by induction basis, a0, a1 and a2 are defined this way. And then if an minus 1, an minus 2 and an minus 3 are defined, then an is also defined. So we conclude that an is defined for all n greater than or equal to 0. Fine. So, these are simple examples. Let me now work out how we can make more complicated constructions using induction as a proof. Okay. First of all, let us think about, let's say, matrix multiplication. Of course, we are not going to define matrix multiplication. I assume that you know how to multiply two matrices. Maybe if I will do this thing. Okay. Now the problem is a little different. In our context, suppose that you have given n matrices, let us call them m0, m1, m2, up to mn. And I would like to compute this product. Of course, I assume that the column dimension of m0 is the same as the row dimension of m1. Column dimension of m1 is equal to the row dimension of m2, so that this makes sense. Okay. Or we may, for that matter, assume all our square matrices of the same dimension. Okay. In any case, I want to compute this product m0, m1, m2 up to mn. Okay. Now, matrix multiplication is not necessarily commutative, right? So, if I write this as m0, m2, m1, this may be a different matrix. This is in general a different matrix. But if we just maintain this order, then this should be a unique matrix. Right? But then, what do we exactly mean by this? And let us see why this, I would say, the meaning of this product actually comes into picture. Take n equal to, let's say 3. Then this product may be interpreted as m0, m1 multiplied by m2 and then finally by m3. This is definitely one interpretation of this. So, it turns out there are actually 4 other interpretations. For example, this is another interpretation. m0, first multiply m1, m2, then m0, and finally multiply by m3. Okay. Then I have another interpretation. Multiply m0 and m1, m2 and m3. Then multiply this. Okay. Then there are 2 other interpretations. M1, M2, M3. And final interpretation is this. M0, M1, M2, M3. So you can see there are 5 ways of making this multiplication of 4 matrices m0, m1, m2 and m3 in this order. Question is, which one is the valid interpretation of this? Okay. Or for that matter, I will make even a stronger proof that whatever be your interpretation of this, the final result is the same matrix. You define it this way or this way or this way or this way or this way, you will eventually get the same matrix. What is the basis of this proof? The basis of this proof is the basic associativity law. Associativity of matrix multiplication. Like this, for any 3 matrices A, B, C, I have AB times C equal to A, B times C. This settles the question for the case n equal to 2, m0, m1, m2. But it does not settle, immediately does not settle the case for the general value of n. So, irrespective of how you parenthesize this product, you will get the same matrix. Okay. But using this associativity and some inductive construction or recursive construction, I will actually show that whatever the value of n is, then you will get a unit matrix irrespective of how, whatever way you parenthesize the product, but you do not, I mean, permute this order. This should be in this sequence, always 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. Okay. Although I am now focusing on matrix multiplication, but this makes sense whenever you have any associative operation. For example, this is, I would say, this general theory holds for any associative operation. For example, you can consider and all of propositions. You have union, intersection of sets, and other things, multiplication of integers, multiplication of real numbers, addition of integers, addition of real numbers, and all that stuff. So, whenever you have an associative operation, I can forget all the brackets and simply write it this way. So, it does not matter whether you make a multiplication from left to right, right to left, or for that matter in any other order, you will get the same thing. We will prove it by induction using this as the basis case. This law is at the very heart of this proof. Okay. So, I prove it only for this multiplication case. All other similar examples are analogous. Okay. Okay. So, in order to prove that, for a matrix multiplication, this is independent of the parenthesization, I first make one interpretation and I will call that the meaning of this. I will consider only one interpretation of this and that I will define inductively, and then I will show that interpretation is equal to any other parenthesization. Okay. So, hence this now involves a recursive construction. Of course, now we are dealing with a, maybe I use another color. So, for n equal to 0, I have m0, there is no problem. For n equal to 1, I have just a product, still there is no confusion arising. Now, whenever I am considering the next one, m0, m1, m2, I will have two different interpretations. So, for n greater than or equal to 2, I define m0, m1, m2, ... mn as n minus 1, mn. Okay. This interpretation we will take. So, how does induction play a role here? It is once again the special case. If it is defined from n equal to 1, then I assume that the n minus 1 fold product is defined. Okay, n greater than equal to 2 means n minus 1 is greater than equal to 1. So this n minus 1 fold is product is defined, and then I compute it this way, and then finally multiply by mn, the last matrix. Okay. So in this interpretation is actually something like this. First you multiply m0, m1, then you multiply by m2, then you multiply by m3, and so on. Eventually you multiply by mn minus 1. And the final multiplication is this. So if you expand this interpretation, I am essentially calling this interpretation as my interpretation of m0 through mn. And I will have to show that this is independent of any other way of parenthesizing or interpreting the product. Okay. Is it clear? So I assume that this interpretation is as per this. And then, if it is defined for any matrices m0 through n minus 1, then I am just extending it by another, by introducing another matrix mn. Okay. So, with this interpretation in hand, what I will do, I will prove is independent of the parenthesization. Okay, so let me come to the proof. Sorry, this is not a proof. This is the claim. I will prove it. Okay, this is not a proof. This is the claim. Okay, proof. So I will use the strong form of induction. Now, we once again look at this. For n equal to 0 and n equal to 1, there is no ambiguity. Ambiguity starts, or maybe even the previous page. Yeah. If there are only two matrices, m0 or one matrix m0, there is no ambiguity. m0, m1, there are only two matrices, then there is also no ambiguity. Ambiguity starts when I have at least three matrices. So, strong form of induction will run for n greater than equal to 2. 3 matrices means n greater than equal to 2. So, m0, m1, m2. Okay. So, what is my basis? By my interpretation, m0, m1, m2 is nothing but m0, m1 followed by m2. But by the associativity law, this is same as m0, m1, m2, and these are the only two ways of parenthesizing the product. So this is by law of associativity. Okay. Now we will do this inductive step. So I will assume that m0, m1, mr are defined okay, defined, or I would say unique, independent of parenthesization. Okay, let me rewrite it this way. I am proving something. R independent of parenthesization. Okay, for, well, maybe I require it for all 0, 1, 2, up to n minus 1. Okay, so, of course, 0 and 1, this cases are not very interesting. So, we can anyway assume that they come for free. Okay, I am proving for n greater than or equal to 2. So, from this onward, 2 to n minus 1 I have proved. This is what I assume. Okay. So, now I introduce this, a new matrix Mn. And I interpret it as this times Mn. Okay. Now, consider any parenthesization of this. Okay. Any parenthesization. Or, no, I should proceed this way. Consider any parenthesization of this. And I will show this will eventually be equal to this interpretation. Okay. So, now take which is not necessarily of this form. Okay. If it is of this form, then we are actually fine. Otherwise, we have to do something like this. So, in this parenthesization, I will look at the position of the last multiplication. Suppose it is at position R. This is somehow parenthesized, this is somehow parenthesized, and this is the last multiplication. Okay. Fine. And then I consider two cases. The first one is the easy case, second one is the difficult case. So, first I assume that that position R is equal to n minus 1. Then what is this parenthesization? This is m0, m1, m minus 1, mn. Okay. Now I know this is my actually defined interpretation of m0, 1 on through mn. And this product, this is independent of how I parenthesize this. Okay. So, there are two things. First, this is the interpretation. And in addition, this guy, this product in our interpretation is independent of parenthesization. So, this tallies with our interpretation. So, what happens? What is the problem here? This is not yet immediately obvious if R is n minus 1. So, we have a situation like this. M0, M1, MR. Then, I have at least two matrices, MR plus 1 through we write down this way, Mn minus 1, Mn. Of course, Mn only two matrices, but at least two matrices. Okay. So now I have to show that this is again same as this interpretation. But how many matrices are there? This contains at least some matrices. At least the last multiplication may be R may be greater than or equal to 0. So the last multiplication may be at this N0 position. Whatever it is, at least one matrix must come here. Okay. So the number of matrices here is less than N plus 1. So by induction again, the way I parenthesize this is the result of this multiplication by induction. So this is by induction, but this time it is by strong induction. This product is independent of parenthesization. Okay. Moreover, by our interpretation, this is nothing but the product this Mn minus 1 Mn. Well, this is our interpretation. So this is by our interpretation. Okay. Now, again, finally I use the associativity law of our matrix multiplication. So I can now write this as now, again, you see that this is a way of parenthesizing n matrices n0 through mn minus 1. By induction, therefore, the final product is independent of how you parenthesize this. So, I can simply write this as m0, m1 up to mn minus 1. Finally, you multiply mn. So eventually, even if the parenthesization is not of this desired form, I eventually prove that it is equal to the same matrix if defined in this form. Right. Okay, this is a much more complicated proof than all the previous things because there is a fine logic behind this. Okay. So you think about the proof and try to understand what is this. But then, eventually by recursive construction, I have proved that when I talk about the product m0, m1, m2 up to mn, I do not need to show any parenthesization. Whatever way we parenthesize this product, we get the same matrix. Okay. But then, there is another important thing for which I am introducing this matrix multiplication. Is I will now establish the relation of Catalan numbers with the number of way of parenthesizations, and that will give me something like a recurrence relation for Catalan numbers. Okay. So in general, what I will prove, the number of of this product m1, m2, sorry, I start from m0, up to mn. Up to mn, m0, m1, up to mn. Is equal to the nth Catalan number Cn. Okay, this proof is not going to be so easy, but anyway, doable, and this is not exactly an application of induction. This I will prove in it by using a specific construction. Okay. So, on the one hand, I have the Catalan numbers are defined as a set of paths, valid paths, from 0,0 to n,n. So that is how we have defined Catalan numbers, the size of this set. How many number of, how many valid paths are there from 0,0 to n,n. By valid means, it never crosses the line y equal to x. And I have a set of, parenthesizations, of m0, m1, m2, up to mn. And I will show that these two sets are of the same size. Okay, so let us give some names to these. Maybe this set is called A, this set is called B. What I will do, I will produce a construction from A to B that will take a valid path P and will create a parenthesization of this product. And I leave it to you to reverse this construction. We'll start from a parenthesization, let us call it Q. From that, you make the construction G to get a path, valid path, such that if you start from P, apply F, you will get Q, and then you apply G, you get back the same path P with which you started. Okay, so then we have G compose F is the identity of A, or the other way around. You start with a parenthesization, get a path, then apply this construction F, you will get the same parenthesization. So either this or this, identity map of B. We should show that both F and G are bijective functions, 1,1 and n,2,1,2, and therefore these two sets are of the same size. And this F and G are inverses of one another. Okay. So, I will do the construction from A to B. Given a valid path, how can I parenthesize this product? Okay. So, instead of telling you in very general terms, I explain it using an example. How much, maybe n equal to 4, let me take. So, the construction F. From paths to parenthesizations. Okay, so the general principle will be the same, but I will just illustrate the construction for n equal to 4. Okay. So I have a 4 by 4 grid. which means I need this, 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 somewhere here, here, here. Good. And then let me superimpose a path on it. Maybe I will come from here to here, then from here to here, then maybe I will move up, maybe then once again I will move right, up, then once again up, maybe one right, finally up. And if I consider this line, starting from here to here, you see that this is a valid path because it never crosses y equal to x line. Okay, so this is 0 comma 0, this is n comma n, in our case it is 4. Okay, so now I have to somehow parenthesize n equal to 4, right? So m0, m1, m2, m3, m4. Okay. So what I will do, I will use a stack. And I will mark this horizontal of these columns by m1, m2, M3, M4. Okay. So, whenever I move right along this given path, then whatever is here, I will just look at this this matrix M1. I will push it to the top of the stack. Push to the M2 to the top of the stack. And whenever I make an upward move, I will pop the top two elements from the stack, multiply them, and we'll push the parenthesized multiplication product to the top of the stack. So I keep on doing, eventually M1, M2, M3 and M4, everybody will be considered. So let us see how it works this way. So I will show how this stack grows corresponding to this path, here to here to here to here 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 here. Okay. So initially my stack contains only M0. And I pushed M0 irrespective of this path. Okay. Then I see that this is a horizontal move. So I will push the corresponding M1 here. Okay. Then I see we had again another horizontal move, left-right move. So I will once again push M2. Okay, so this is move number 1, move number 2, move number 3, move number 4, move number 5, 6, 7 and 8. So this is init before any move. So after move 1, after move 2, I have this. Then there is a vertical movement, upward movement. Okay, maybe I make it a little bigger. Otherwise I cannot handle. Okay, so where am I? Yeah. Now when the third move is upward, so as I mentioned, what I will do is this. I will pop this and write their parenthesized product back to the stack. So M0 will stay as it is. I will pop the top two elements and then I will push M1. M2. This is after consuming the third move. Okay, so let me delete. Okay, basis. And the fourth move is a horizontal move. So I will simply push M3. So M0 will be like this, M1, M2 will stay with this parenthesis. Now M3 will come here. Okay. This is after consuming or processing move number 4. Then move number 5 is an upward move, vertical move. So I will pop this and multiply them and push it back to the stack. This is move number 5. This is a vertical move. So M0 will continue to stay here. Pop, pop, multiply, push. So it will be something like this. Then, move number 6, it is once again a vertical move, so I have to make another multiplication. Okay, so I will pop this first, this, and then multiply and push. So this will give me M0. M1, M2. M3, right? Okay. Then this happens after move 6, and move 7 is a horizontal move. So I will just push M4. So this is step 6 and 7. Finally, we see a vertical move. So I will pop two elements and multiply. M1, M2, M3, is there another bracket needed? 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, yes, needed. Then M4, yes, this. Okay, so maybe I just delete this, this looks not good. Extend this. Where am I? Here. Okay. So this is the final step after move number 8. So this is how I converted this path to this parenthesization. Okay. Of course, the last outermost bracket is not necessary, but anyway, let us skip it. Okay. So, that's it. This is a general case. Now, first of all, why does this construction work? Okay. So, you start, one thing you see, whenever you make a horizontal move, rightward move, you are increasing the size of the stack by 1. Because it's a push operation, plain push operation. And so this is a push, stack size increases by 1. Whereas whenever you encounter a pop operation or encounter an upward move, you pop 2 elements and push 1 element. So the stack size reduces by 1. Okay. But since your path never crosses this blue line, y equal to x line, you will always be able, whenever you are making a vertical move, to find at least 2 elements sitting on the, in the stack. So in that case, you pop them and multiply and push. So you never run out of elements, or in other words, initial size is 1 in it, okay. And whenever you hit the I would say, what is this called, the diagonal or the equal to x line, after the processing you have only one element. Okay, like we have done it here after step 6, yeah, before pushing M4, we had only one element. But at that point of time, I will never try to cross it, and crossing essentially means popping two elements, but after step 6, only one element is sitting. But anyway, since now I have 7, is the horizontal movement, I have another element, and eventually when I again touch this at the end, I have the complete product. So this works, right? This is a valid construction from this set to this set. Now you propose a reverse construction. If given something like this, you can generate this path, the same path. If you are given this, generate the same path. Okay. So, I leave it to you. The only thing is that whenever you can use it as something like a stack or something, not necessarily a stack. Whenever you see CM0, you simply keep on right, moving right. M0 is anyway, you do not consider, because M0 is at the beginning. Init position of the stack. M1 you found, so make a rightward move. M2 again rightward move. As soon as you see the closing parenthesis, you move up. So move up. Then M3 you see, once again move left. Then you see two consecutive closing parenthesis. So up, up. Then M4, move right, final closing parenthesis, move up. Okay, so this is basically the reverse construction. I have basically mentioned it, but you work out the details. Okay, so the question is, why did I establish this bijection? What is the reason? So that reason I will now explain. Okay, so what I will do now, I will deduce a recurrence relation, or maybe I will not use this term now, because we specify it in another way. Okay. So, I will now define the Catalan numbers, not by using that path way, or the combinatorial way, define the Catalan numbers recursively. Because now I can say CM is equal to the number of parenthesizations of M0, M1, M2 up to MN. Okay. So, I will now use, having established that bijection, I can now use this interpretation of Catalan numbers. And I can now define Catalan numbers recursively. Okay, so first of all, what is C0? There is only one matrix. So, there is no parenthesization actually. So, there is a unique way of interpreting this. C1 also we can define as 1, but it is actually not necessary. Okay, so now take n greater than equal to 1, which means I have at least two matrices, m0, m1, up to mn, but I keep space for this. So now I have to somehow parenthesize this. Okay, so let us say once again, as in that proof, I parenthesize this and then the remaining portion, MR plus 1, like this, and then compute the final product. Okay. So, what are the possibilities for R? 0 less than equal to R less than equal to n minus 1. So, R is the position of the last multiplication. Okay, as we have used in the proof. Okay. So, for different values of R, I will get different parenthesizations because I am excluding the different cases for different positions of the last multiplication. Okay. So, these are mutually exclusive. Okay. So, now, what is the number of ways of parenthesizing this? By induction, this is precisely C of R. And if I call this 0, then I should subtract R plus 1 from all the indices. So, this now becomes n minus R minus 1. So, the number of ways of parenthesizing this is C of R, and the number of ways of parenthesizing this is C of n minus R minus 1. And these two parenthesizations are independent of one another. Any way you can parenthesize this part, any way you can parenthesize this part, and you can clap together these two parenthesizations. So, by the product rule, you have CR and CN minus R minus 1. And then I vary R between 0 to N minus 1. And again by the, this is no longer by the product rule, this is by the sum rule because these cases are mutually exclusive. I have the sum R equal to 0 to N minus 1. That is nothing but the value of Cn. So, if I expand it, this will look like C0, Cn minus 1, C1, Cn minus 2, C2, Cn minus 3, and so on. Eventually, you have Cn minus 1, C0. Okay. So, once again you see that the strong form of mathematical induction now says that the Catalan numbers are defined for all n greater than or equal to 0. This is the basis case and this is the strong assumption case. If C0, C1, C2, C3 all up to Cn minus 1 are defined, then Cn is also defined. Okay. So, by strong induction, the strong form of induction. Cn is defined for all n greater than or equal to 0. Good. So, you have at least 3-4 interpretations of Catalan numbers. And you also now have a cool so-called recurrence relation for Catalan numbers ready. In a later chapter during generating functions, I will use this recurrence relation in order to derive that formula Cn equal to the 1 over n plus 1 to n choose n in a completely algebraic way without any combinatorial interpretation, but by a complete algebraic way I will define. But we have to wait until we understand what is meant by generating functions. Okay. Good. So, I would like to make yet another construction before ending this lecture. This is once again an example of the strong form of induction. Okay. So, these objects are called, so far we have been essentially dealing with sequences and all that stuff. Now, I will recursively define a set of, a class of trees called binomial trees. It's getting very bad. We will come to the obvious question, why these are called binomial trees. So I will give you a couple of exercises on this. A binomial tree is a rooted tree. In fact, it's a family of rooted tree, BN, defined for all n greater than or equal to 0. Okay, and I use the inductive definition, recursive definition. This is n equal to 0. So then this is a single node tree. Something like this, which is also the root. Okay. Now, inductive step is that I assume that B0, B1 up to BN minus 1 are defined. Then I construct BN as follows. Okay. So take a new root, then I have, okay, actually the different authors use different directions, but anyway it doesn't matter. So B0 is a rooted tree, B1 is a rooted tree, and so on up to BN minus 1 is a rooted tree. So this is my B0, this is B1. This is BN minus 1. And I make this new root the parent of this N subtrees. This is how I construct the nth binomial tree BN, or the binomial tree of order N. Okay. So this is the recursive construction. Once again, by the strong case, or the strong form of induction, this is defined for all n greater than or equal to 0. Okay. So let me give you an example how binomial trees of small orders can be generated using this definition. Okay. Maybe I change the color. Okay. So this is B0. And if I consider B1, okay, maybe I B1, okay, write it somewhere else. So my B0 is like this. It is a single node. B1 will have only one child. Okay, the root will have only one child, which will be B0. This is B0. Okay. B2, the root will have two child, one corresponding to B1, which is defined this way. Or what did I use? Let me see. From B0 to BN minus 1. Okay. Then let me change this. Let me change this. Okay. This is also fine. Okay. So it will have two subtrees, B0 and B1. First one is B0, so it will be this. Second one is B1, it will be this. Okay, so this is B1, this is B0, this is B1. What about B3? Here the root will have three subtrees. First one is B0, the second one is B1. B1 is nothing but this. And the third one is this tree, B2. Okay. So B4 will have four child, Maybe it will have four child. The first subtree is this, second subtree is this, third subtree is this, and fourth subtree is this. Okay. This is how this construction goes. Okay. Good. I hope you understand this recursive construction now. I end with an exercise. But first, let me introduce some conventions. So, I say that this is the level 0. This is level 1 in the tree. These 3, they are at level 2. Finally, this is level 3. And the largest level is called the height of the tree. This is not a binary tree. This is an arbitrary tree. Because a node can have arbitrary number of child. Okay. So, the exercise says like this. Prove the following assertions about BN. These proofs are essentially inductive proofs. One, BN contains 2 power n nodes in total. 2, BN contains 2 power n minus 1 nodes, sorry, leaf nodes. But definitely this is true only for n greater than or equal to 1, not n equal to 0. This is true for any n greater than or equal to 0. And 3, the height of Bn is n, and now this will give a justification why these are called binomial trees. There are n choose I nodes at level I for all I ranging from 0, 1, 2 up to n. Since the height is n, the maximum level is n. This is this. Okay, so because of this binomial coefficient, this is called a binomial tree. Okay, these are called binomial trees. Okay, so you see that using inductive proofs or inductive constructions, we can have many interesting objects like parenthesization, Catalan number, some interpretation of Catalan numbers, an equivalent definition of Catalan numbers, binomial trees and so on. We will see many more examples of recursive constructions in future. So let me stop for the moment. In the next class, I will rephrase induction and in terms of what is called loop invariance, and this will be used for program verification, actually for the iterative programs. Okay, so until then, goodbye.